This is TechSlant, episode 122, recorded live May 13th, 2016. There's no contingency plan for stupid. Hello and welcome to another episode of TechSlant. I'm Donovan Adkisson, and I'm joined by my co-host and good friend, Samuel Lewis. Hey, Sam, how's it going?
Doing great. Went and saw Captain America Civil War today, and it was fantastic. The hype is real. The hype is real. So,
yeah, you know me. I'll eventually see it whenever it becomes available as a digital download, which means, let's see, this is May. I might get to see it about August.
Yeah. So, around that, probably.
Yeah, so that's fine with me. So, because when did Deadpool come out? February? Or was it around December? I can't remember.
Yeah, I can't remember either. But I know it felt like it came out quick to DVD and everything, so.
Yeah, because, I mean, you know, we watched it 2 weekends ago. And that previous Tuesday is whenever it came out and was available as a digital download, which is when I got it. So yeah, that's what I'm thinking. 3-4 months from release date of the theaters, it'll probably be like August.
Yeah.
So I'll get to see it then. All right. Well, anyway, this is our bi-weekly tech show called TechSlant, where we, every other Friday around somewhere between 7 and 7:30, there seems to be the disparity now. I'm getting old, so I'm probably not recalling it correctly, so that's okay.
We kept on doing it at 7:30, so I actually just assumed it was 7:30. So.
You're probably not wrong, but never mind. Anyway, all right, so let's get into our stories, and I'm going to let you kick it off.
Totally. Okay. The Wall Street Journal reports that Hulu is planning on a new web subscription service that would sell live and on-demand programming from programmers such as ESPN, ABC, Fox, and FX for about $40 a month starting early next year. Turns out the TV networks, the ones who sell their programming to Comcast and Time Warner Cable, think that it's a good idea too. Disney and 21st Century Fox, which own two-thirds of Hulu and control its management, want to sell a service that competes directly with the pay TV distributors, who are their most important customers. That means if you want to watch Empire and the college football playoffs on ESPN or the other big-ticket programming from the network's control, you no longer have to get it from traditional pay TV distributors like Comcast. You can get it from the networks themselves.
Ex-professional Counter-Strike player turned full-time streamer Eric Flom was rudely interrupted mid-game and live on Twitch by Windows 10 automatically installing on his PC. Initial outrage flowed into jubilation as it appeared that Windows 10 was nearing completion, only for Flom to have his hopes dashed by a second installation countdown. The whole lot was captured live on game video streaming service Twitch through a video capture system, which remained operational while the gaming PC installed Windows 10. This is perhaps the first recorded instance of Windows 10 installing automatically while a user is actively using their PC. I can only imagine.
That is a nightmare.
Right. And the reason why it was captured, of course, is a lot of these seasoned streamers actually have a two-rig system.
Yeah.
Because they have their actual encoding/streaming box, which has a capture card in it. And then, of course, they have their main machine that they're actually playing the video game on. And that way you get the best bang for the buck. You don't have to worry about overloading the machine. And but to be right in the middle of a game and then suddenly, I mean, Windows 10 is supposed to actually be cognizant of the fact that you're doing something, but apparently it's not that aware. Not yet, anyway.
Apparently not.
You would think with Cortana on board, it would be, but anyway.
Yeah, she had that tour of duty with Master Chief. You would think that she would know stuff by now.
I know, right?
But anyway. Amazon unveiled its own plans to compete in the user-generated video market with the launch of a new service called Amazon Video Direct. This service allows creators to upload their own videos to Amazon's Prime Video and generate royalties based on the hours streamed. The self-serve platform reaches the company's tens of millions of Prime members. Many of those customers are already engaged with Amazon Prime Video as they use this Netflix-like service to watch Amazon's free TV shows and movies, including the replacement to Top Gear coming soon, including both popular network TV and Hollywood films, as well as Amazon's own original content. In addition, Amazon says that its creators will have control over where their videos can be streamed. For now, that means they can be streamed in countries where Amazon Video is available, the U.S., Germany, Austria, the United Kingdom, and Japan. These videos can be played back anywhere Amazon Video works, as well, which includes mobile phones and tablets, you know, Fire, iOS, Android, desktop, game consoles, connected TV platforms, and Fire TV. So this is interesting, although there's a lot of rules involved with this one, if I'm not mistaken, right?
Yeah, whenever you first shared this story, I actually went and looked into it, and it was a little confusing to begin with because I already have an Amazon account, so I was going to try to use that one, and I tried to log in with that one, and it didn't let me log in. So I went through the whole create account process, and when I did that, I wound up actually logging in with the one with my actual Amazon account. So I was like, okay, that's confusing. So I got past that, and I started looking through, and I'm like, okay, well, this possibly looks like it could be a good a contender maybe for YouTube. Not really a contender per se, but it's another distribution platform. Let's try to use it. So I go through like I'm going to create a video. Oh, my God. No, no, no. In its current incarnation, there is absolutely no way that this will be a threat to YouTube and user-created content. It is completely 100% geared whenever you go to set it up from the perspective of someone who has shot a short film, mm-hmm. shot a short web series. It wants all of this information. It wants your actors' names, your director. You must have closed caption capability. You must include everything. There's no way. There's absolutely no way in its current form that I feel that it can be a contender for YouTube, especially for what YouTube is used for. People vlog. People like Philip DeFranco. There's no way in hell he would go through for a 10-minute video the process of trying to get it submitted to this video direct stuff at Amazon. No way.
Yeah.
Not a good system.
And I'm not completely sure that they're aiming for the YouTube audience. I mean, everyone says that they're aiming for the YouTube audience because we automatically in the tech journalism go, a streaming video service. It must be after YouTube. But I think you're onto something with it being more the short film crowd and stuff like that. And for that, YouTube is okay for that crowd. So maybe Amazon streaming might be a better route for them to go for that sort of thing.
Yeah, you really have to have your I's dotted and your T's crossed whenever you're ready to submit video. You got to have 16x9 banners. You got to have 4x3 banners. And it's not like it's going to let you go, oh, no, I don't want, no. It's a necessity. You try to submit it without it, it's, nope, sorry. You can't do anything until you have these.
Okay.
All right. This is something I'm sort of familiar with. Charter Communications prevented customers from using their own modems for 2 years beginning in 2012. And as punishment, the company will have to pay a $640,000 fine and complete a 3-year compliance plan. The Federal Communications Commission, the FCC, entered into a consent decree with Charter to settle the commission's investigation into the matter, and it released the decree on Tuesday. Charter's actions were no secret, but Charter, which just got FCC approval to complete a merger that will make it the nation's second largest cable company, monopoly, got away with it until the FCC stepped in. Quote, the Bureau's investigation found that for a period of approximately 2 years beginning in 2012, Charter informed subscribers that they would no longer be permitted to attach new customer-owned modems. This is from the FCC. Charter later provided a list of authorized customer-owned modems, but new modems were only added to the list after passing a number of tests, many of which did not relate to harm to the network or theft of service. Charter customers who already used third-party modems before the policy went into place were allowed to keep using them. Because of the FCC investigation, Charter is shortening its modem testing to a period of 3 weeks, and that $640,000 fine is going to be paid to the U.S. Treasury. Yeah. Now, what I'm about to say, there are some caveats. But there is a standard in cable broadband for a reason. It's called DOCSIS. I can't remember the exact acronym anymore. It's like data over cable something. Anyway, I used to know it right off the top of my head, but I've been out of that for 4 or 5 years now. But as long as a modem is a DOCSIS-compliant modem, if it's a... Now we're on what's called DOCSIS 3, and they've actually started rolling out 3.1. And essentially, every iteration of DOCSIS gave us faster speeds, faster download speeds, and faster upload speeds. So if a cable system supports DOCSIS 2, pretty much all of them now support DOCSIS 3. As long as it's a DOCSIS 3 modem, there's absolutely no testing that they really need to do. Now, I will say this. You typically, because of the way modems are provisioned, configuration files are sent down, and that's how you get modems upgraded with newer firmware, is if they primarily use, say, like Motorola cable modems, particular models of Motorola or Aris, then they'll have the mechanism in place that if there's a new firmware that possibly solves an issue with a particular line of modems that they have, then when those modems come up, it automatically gets updated. So if you've got some off-brand modem that they don't have anything for, as long as it can get its configuration file, it should still work. So this whole, oh, we want to test and make sure, the modem's not going to harm the network. The modem's either going to work or it's not going to work. What they're doing is they don't want you to own that damn thing because they want that $4, $5, or $6 a month that they're charging you for it.
They want you to rent it.
Just like the freaking set-top boxes. So,
yeah.
You know, shame on you, Charter. I'm glad you got it in the butt, $640,000.
Lovely way to put it. Anyway, web searches that use, here we go, we're back to Cortana again. Web searches that use Cortana-driven search box in the Windows 10 taskbar will no longer give you any choice. They will always open in Bing, and they will always use Edge to do so. Even though you can select your default browser and search engine system-wide, Microsoft explains that it's making this change because of the smarter capabilities that it has built into its Cortana Digital Personal Assistant and the integration this requires of the browser and search engine. For example, the company says that a search for Pizza Hut in Cortana will, when opened up in Edge, show locations and directions and rich information. Although, what rich information you could get from Pizza Hut, I have no idea. Plans are afoot to make this feature more capable and extensive. Eventually, you'll be able to ask Cortana to get tickets to the Rihanna show. Again, don't know why you'd do that. And Windows will find appropriate tickets and streamline a customer's purchase. No bias showed by Samuel Lewis at all while he was reading this.
None whatsoever. I have to... I've got a little confession to make. I'm actually impressed with Cortana's ability to actually listen to and recognize voice communication. I was in here, it was probably, it was 2 weekends ago, and Lee was in here doing some stuff because, you know, the majority of this out here is actually still sewing stuff, and I've only got a small section for the studio. So I was just sitting here playing around with this laptop that I'm using right now, and it's Windows 10 and it's got Cortana. And I was actually amazed at, I would say the key phrase, which I'm not saying now because I don't want it to actually kick up and get in my way. But I would ask
we don't want to set off everyone else's PCs that might be watching this either.
Yeah, I know, right? So, and I would ask her, like, is it going to be hot today? And she would bring up the weather and actually say, I don't think so, you know, based on the temperature and stuff like that. So,
nice.
I'm not sure, as far as my experience with Cortana versus Google or Google Now, I think they're kind of on par as far as search on a computer. Now, you know, we don't have any experience with Cortana on a smartphone, and I'm not sure we ever will.
Right.
I think at one time they were talking about making Cortana an app and bringing it out, and I said it, and she just popped up. Okay. But I think they're very comparable, actually. So I was impressed. But I don't like the fact that you're going to make it only use Bing for search, and you're only going to bring... And I noticed that every time I would do this voice search, it would actually pop up Edge. It wouldn't pop up any other browser. And my default browser is Chrome on this system. It would always pop up Edge. And
yeah.
Edge is actually not that bad of a browser. I'm not giving it high marks as a replacement for Chrome, of course, but because it's still a little baby, still a little infant. But
right.
It's clean, and I think it's got potential. I would say it's definitely better than Internet Explorer.
that's not too high of a bar to cross over, if we're honest.
Oh, yeah, that's true. All right. I had to get a little drink of water because this one's lengthy.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. So, the government hacking into phones and seizing computers remotely? Well, yep. If a proposal from an obscure committee that proposes changes to court procedures is approved and goes into effect in December of this year. The proposal comes from the Advisory Committee on Criminal Rules for the Judicial Conference of the United States. The amendment would update Rule 41 of the Federal Rules of Criminal Procedure, creating a sweeping expansion of law enforcement's ability to engage in hacking and surveillance. The Supreme Court just passed the proposal to Congress, which has until December the 1st to disavow the change, or it becomes the rule governing every federal court across the country. The first part of this change would grant authority to practically any judge to issue a search warrant to remotely access, seize, or copy data relevant to a crime when a computer was using privacy protective tools to safeguard one's location. Many different commonly used tools might fall into this category. For example, people who use Tor, folks running a Tor node, or people using a VPN would certainly be implicated. It might also extend to people who deny access to location data for smartphone apps because they don't feel like sharing their location with ad networks. It could even include individuals who change the country setting in an online service, like folks who change the country settings of their Twitter profile in order to read uncensored tweets. The second part of the proposal would grant authorization to a judge to issue a search warrant for hacking, seizing, or otherwise infiltrating computers that may be part of a botnet. This means victims of malware would find themselves doubly infiltrated, their computers infected with malware and used to contribute to a botnet, and then government agents given free rein to remotely access their computers as part of the investigation. Even with the best of intentions, a government agent could well cause as much or even more harm to a computer through remote access than the malware that originally infected the computer, and malicious actors may even be able to hijack the malware because, well, let's face it, the government is not that great at designing secure software. So the government access to the computers of botnet victims also raises serious privacy concerns. as a wide range of sensitive, unrelated personal data could well be accessed during the investigation. This is a very dangerous expansion of powers, and it's not something that should be granted without an actual public debate on this topic. That is scary.
Yeah, it is. I mean, but me and you usually agree on this point, is that we don't like the government getting involved in our stuff. Funny, I've been talking about this all day, given that we talked about Captain America Civil War earlier.
Team Tony! Team Tony!
Okay, you do know what that means. Anyway.
Yes, I know exactly what it means.
We are going to have a discussion later, I think. Anyway. Yep. Fine then. This will be a fascinating post-show discussion. But yeah, I just don't like government interference in anything like that. And particularly something like this, it's just doubly so. Because as much as, and I've always joked, this is sort of a weird dichotomy with me, that I share my life as openly as I do, I still think when it comes to the government getting involved, heck no, I still have that privacy.
Yeah.
I mean, because I don't share everything, right? You know, there's stuff, quite frankly, I don't share with the public because the public doesn't want to know.
Underwear so, size, yeah.
Yeah, things like that. Things that are like, it's like, dude, why'd you tell us that? None of us wanted to hear that, you know? So that's the sort of stuff. And just, that's the sort of stuff they'd probably be digging into.
So well, just so you know, mine is medium 32 to 34.
Okay, if I ever get you a Christmas present, I'll go for the stereotype.
There you go. I couldn't help it. It was too easy.
Oh, yeah. I would have went there, too. So.
Oh. All right. So we want to move on to our main topic. This one is very, very interesting. Because it deals with renewable energy. And, you know, that's the whole climate... And I hate calling it climate change because, come on, let's be clear. It's global warming. Climate changes constantly. You know, whenever I woke up this morning, the climate was, you know, X amount of degrees, 70 degrees. 30 minutes later, guess what? The climate had changed.
Yeah.
So I absolutely hate that terminology. And the only reason why they did that, of course, and not to veer off into the political landscape, was to try to make it more palatable to people because they'd already started getting beaten over the head about the whole global warming thing. Anyway, yeah. So it's in our best interest, of course, to try to get off of fossil fuels as best we can and as soon as we can and try not to bankrupt our countries while we do it.
Yeah.
So on Sunday, May 8th, last Sunday, Germany, of all places... And, of course, there again, Germany is one of these that have decided to completely take down all of their nuclear plants by, like, 2025 or 2030 or something like that, which I think is still a little bit ludicrous, but of all of the safe power in the world, renewable energies like solar and wind and hydro and nuclear, you don't get any better than that.
Yeah, unless you have Homer Simpson at the controls, but we don't. So
well,
we should be
yeah,
safe.
Okay. I can't have a contingency for stupid, okay? Jeez. All right. So anyway, May 8th, they hit a new high on renewable energy generation. They had a very sunny and windy day, and so at one point around 1 p.m., their solar, wind, hydro, and biomass plants were supplying about 55 gigawatts of the 63 gigawatts being consumed, or roughly 87%. Their power prices actually went in the negative for several hours, meaning that commercial customers were being paid to consume electricity.
Pretty much.
I mean, how awesome is that?
Yeah.
They said last year the average renewable mix was about 33%. And then they've got new wind power coming online should push that even higher. Christoph Podewils, I guess, of Agora, which is the German clean energy think tank, said, "We have a greater share of renewable energy every year. The power system adapted to this quite nicely. This day shows again that a system with large amounts of renewable energy works fine." because you do have your naysayers out there. Especially, and I hate to say this, they all seem to be on the right-wing conservative side of the crowd. It's like, oh, look at your solar power, your solar farms. It's costed so much money, and you're only putting out a little of power. And that's not the case. Because, of course, critics have argued that because of the daily peaks and troughs of renewable energy, you know, as the sun goes in and out, winds rise and fall, that it will always have only a niche role in supplying power to major economies. But with this, this is actually looking less and less likely. Germany is planning to hit 100% renewable energy by 2050. And Denmark's wind turbines already at some points generate more electricity than their country can actually consume, and then they export the surplus to Germany, Norway, and Sweden.
Feels like SimCity. I'm having flashbacks.
Now, of course, it said Germany's power surplus on Sunday wasn't all good news. The system is still too rigid for power suppliers and consumers to respond quickly to price signals. Gas power plants were taken offline. Nuclear and coal plants couldn't be shut down that quickly. So they went on running and had to pay to sell power into the grid for several hours. So the industrial consumers, such as refineries and foundries, earned money by consuming electricity.
Yeah, it's like, that really points out more how inefficient with switching and stuff like that the standard power is. A lot of people are using this as a sort of thing. It's like it's more along the lines of if we're being kind of balanced with this, if we're channeling our inner Tom Merritt with this, it really is more about the inefficiency of the older things more than the efficiency of the newer ones, if that makes sense.
It does. And not only in that respect of being able to switch things out and what have you, but we have built all of our technology. I mean, we're getting a lot better. You know, we get more power-friendly CPUs, more power-friendly electronics and what have you. But as we were building our appliances, even our automobiles, nobody was really concerned about efficiency. It was like, I want power. I don't give a damn how much energy it consumes. I want power.
And we were all Jeremy Clarkson for an amount of time.
Yeah. And so, you know, now we're actually realizing, oh, wait a minute. We need to actually be more mindful of all of the resources that we have on this planet. And we can still get that power, but we need to do it in an efficient manner.
Right.
And so it really is telling how inefficient the old systems are. Some interesting statistics that I did find, and this is in the U.S., major energy sources and percent share of total U.S. electricity generated in 2015. Coal was 33%. Natural gas was 33%. Nuclear was 20%. Hydropower was 6%. Other renewables was 7%. Biomass was 1.6%. Geothermal was 0.4%. Solar was 0.6%. Wind was 4.7%. So it was actually more. We actually have more wind turbines generating, or we have more energy being generated from wind turbines than we do solar. Petroleum was 1%, and other gases is less than 1%. Now, what I didn't know is there's a place called the Copper Mountain Solar Facility, which is a 150-megawatt solar photovoltaic power plant in Boulder City, Nevada. Renewable energy in the United States accounted for 13.2% of the domestically produced electricity in 2012 and 11.2% of total energy generation. Now, that was 2012. According to the U.S. Energy Information Administration, EIA, the latest Electric Power Monthly report, which is has data for the first 6 months of 2014, renewable energy sources such as biomass, geothermal, hydropower, and solar and wind provided 14.3% of the net U.S. electrical generation. Conventional hydropower accounted for 7%, while non-hydro renewable provided an even larger share at 7.3%. Overall, electrical generation from non-hydro renewable energy sources biomass, geothermal, solar and wind expanded by 10.4% compared to the first half of 2013. So, you know, and now we're here in 2016.
Right.
So it's just getting better and better and better.
Yeah.
I'm reminded of, I saw this video a few weeks ago where it was this old school building. I don't know if it was like an elementary school, might have been a junior high. But this guy, he bought the school. And I believe he said, if I'm not mistaken, the power bill for that big building, because it was like 35,000 square feet or something like that.
Right.
It was like $4,000 or $5,000 a month. He retrofitted the thing, has got a solar array across practically the entire top of the school. I think his power bill for that entire thing is $300 a month now.
That's a difference.
And they're going in and he's actually renting out and leasing out the various rooms for people to come in and like do yoga classes, woodworking classes, whatever. He's turned it in basically into a community building where you can go in and rent a room for a month, a day, a week, whatever. And so,
that's pretty sweet.
Yeah.
I like that.
I know. And he's doing everything he can to be based off of renewable energy and recycling. So I mean, to come off of $5,000 a month to $300 a month is astronomical.
Yeah.
So. Oh, and I would like to point out, I just saw something in the chat from the producer. Yes, I know local temp does not equal climate. It was the absurdity. I was making fun of the absurdity of how they change the wording. That's all. That's all. So, but yeah, this is pretty cool. You know, yay to Germany. Maybe we can keep kicking it in the rear and actually, I want a solar, several solar panels on my house. And the way my house is positioned, I can get sun in the morning on one side, and I can get sun in the afternoon on the other. So I just need a few panels on one side, a few panels on the other. And I'm okay with just basically a solar assist system that would actually, you know, assist the grid. And if I were to actually produce enough power that I wasn't pulling anything from the grid, maybe I could even make my meter run backwards, which I don't know if the state of Georgia actually buys back power or not. But I know there's this new initiative by Georgia Power. They're actually getting into the whole solar thing, so there's no telling. Certain states actually have certain they provide tax benefits, tax credits for actually putting in like solar arrays and what have you at your house. So,
yeah, I know we've got some sort of tax credit if you replace your appliances with those energy efficient ones, but I'm not sure about solar policies and stuff like that, if we have anything like that in Kentucky or not.
Yeah, I would really love to have the bigger system where it does do the assist, but it also stores the energy in the batteries, so then I can actually get that assist during the evening hours from the batteries, and also kind of float whenever if there's a power outage from the grid. Hey, I'm up, baby. You know, I don't have to worry about, you know, power outages.
Totally.
But they're still expensive, so. A lot of times, they're getting cheaper, and the panels are getting more efficient, which is good. Because you don't want to spend $125 on a panel that only generates about 20%, you know, converts 20% of the sunlight into energy. You want it a little bit better than that. And of course, my son Tyler knows more about this than I do. He can tell me all about it because he's big into solar and that type of thing. So anyway, but like I said, kudos to Germany. All right. Did I skip anything?
Don't think you did.
Because you know I've gotten really bad at that. All right, well, if that's it, I guess that's going to wrap up the show. So, Sam, where can people find you when you're not talking tech every other Friday here or doing the Wide Open Talk Show Monday and Wednesdays at 2 p.m.
Indeed. You can find me at about.me/labtech7 for all of my social media links. And you can find all of my podcast and other content that I do when I'm not doing stuff for slant.fm. You can find me at tscn.tv.
And go show him some love. Go to tscn.tv and /support and support him on Patreon. Do it.
You're good. You're going to plug that every time because you know I'm not going to, don't you?
I got to save you from yourself.
Yeah.
So go over there and support him. He makes great stuff. All right. Everything I'm doing is over at slant.fm, and all my social media stuff can be found at about.me/gdadkissing. And if you have any feedback, the email address is feedback@slant.fm. And if you want to leave a voicemail, the number is 313-718-2557. We record this show every other Friday at, 7:30 p.m. now. So come join us for
We can go to 7 if you want. You just have to tell me this.
It's going to be 7 or 7:30. Show up at 7 and then we'll see what happens.
Okay.
Anyway, come join us for our next episode, which will be on May 27th. We'll see you then. Take care. Production of the Slant FM Digital Network. Find more at slant.fm.